The coral reef ecosystem is a complex city of hundreds of thousands of species of diverse sea creatures. These reefs can reach up to 133,000 square miles, as seen by the Great Barrier Reef, which contains over 400 species of coral, 1,500 species of fish, 4,000 species of mollusk, and 6 species of turtle. To keep this ecosystem healthy, each animal is specially adapted to complete a certain task in the coral reef. Cyanobacteria, phytoplankton, zooxanthellae, seagrass, and brown algae are primary producers. These are some of the species that stir off the coral reef food web. Producers are species that use the process of photosynthesis to make their own food. These producers give oxygen, take away carbon dioxide, and provide food for primary consumers. Some primary consumers include zooplankton, sponges, sea urchins, crustaceans, and herbivorous fish, such as species of tang, parrotfish, and triggerfish. These herbivorous animals, especially parrotfish and sea urchins, clear out algae and seagrass to prevent an accumulation of too much oxygen that could kill them and the corals. Unlike popular thought, corals also are primary consumers. Anyways, after the primary consumers, you have secondary consumers, which can be carnivores or omnivores. These include eels, octopus, sea turtles, stingray, squid, cuttlefish, and some other crustaceans.
For me, the most interesting thing in nature
is to keep the population of primary consumers balanced so that they don't eat the producers, which keep the carbon dioxide and oxygen levels stable. Above these secondary consumers are the tertiary consumers, which are more commonly known as apex predators. These include reef sharks, barracudas, groupers, moray eels, and jacks. They are in charge of keeping the population of secondary and primary consumers in balance so that they don't wipe out each other, bacteria, and plants. These apex predators usually develop impressive ways to get their prey. For example, moray eels have two jaws. Its external jaw is used to hold onto prey, while their internal jaw eats and pulls the prey into its mouth. Moray eels also strangle their victims with their tail to prevent escape. There are also decomposers, which break down problematic bacteria, fecal matter, and dead sea animals to reduce infections problems in the coral ecosystem. Some coral reef decomposers include fanworms, sea cucumbers, snails, crabs, bristle worms, and bacteria. Most of these decomposers have different ways of life that specialize in a certain task. For example, the sea cucumber eats bacteria and microorganisms that can be dangerous and poop them out as sand that can be quite nutritious for other living beings. By now, you might be thinking, how come apex predators don't easily wipe out the populations of all the other forms in the coral reefs? Well, the whole system is balanced by the reproductive systems of each animal in the food system. Take phytoplankton. It lives for 1 or 2 days, is microscopic, and doesn't have defense. These factors make it sit at the bottom of the coral reef food web. Because of its high vulnerability, it has to mass reproduce to keep the species alive. They do this by binary fission, a process that causes a bacteria to double in size and genetic material, then split in half. In just a few seconds, a population of 1 million phytoplankton can easily double into 2 million. As you go higher and higher in the coral reef food web, reproduction lowers and maturity span get longer. There are also some outliers in the system, like the barracuda, jack, and moray eel. These all are apex predators, but they still lay thousands of eggs every breeding season. Luckily, it will take them many years for these animals to reach maturity, and after female lays the eggs, they leave them floating in the sea. She does this in hopes that a male will fertilize them. But these eggs are tiny and can be an easy meal for predators or scavengers nearby. This all falls into the process of balance for the ecosystem. Sadly, in recent years, human activity has damaged these wonderful ecosystems by a tremendous scale. In many places, such as the Caribbean, coral reefs are experiencing a massive decline in parrotfish populations due to overfishing. Parrotfish are one of the major grazers in coral reefs. Just one parrotfish can eat up to 200 pounds of algae a year. So because of the decline of these important grazers, coral reefs are getting taken over by algae and seaweed. Parrotfish also can sense nearby predators. This causes the parrotfish to run away, signaling other fish of danger and saving their lives. So without as much parrotfish, other marine grazers are more timid and don't reduce seaweed and algae as effectively as before. Overfishing of sharks is also a problem, since without them, secondary consumer populations are rising and are eating too many primary consumers, which are also causing large algae blooms. Man-made pollutants such as oil spills, unhealthy plant fertilizers, runoff sewage, and plastic pollution all are endangering these ecosystems by killing off helpful turtles, fish, and thousands of marine life. All these factors are dangerous to the coral reef ecosystem, but the most dangerous thing that is happening to them is coral bleaching. Coral bleaching is caused by climate change. Even though climate change is happening in the atmosphere, it's also affecting the oceans. Just a few degrees above the usual temperature can be catastrophic in coral reef ecosystems. In just a few weeks of climate being just a few degrees higher than average, entire reefs can bleach. Corals turn this color when bleached because of the coral's mutualistic symbiotic relationship with zooxanthellae. Symbiotic mutualism in animals is when both species benefit by working together. This is no different with coral and zooxanthellae. Zooxanthellae lives inside each coral polyp and produces up to 99% of a coral's diet and nutrients through the process of photosynthesis. In exchange, the coral gives the zooxanthellae a place near the sun to live, carbon dioxide, and phosphorus. This interspecies relationship gives the coral polyps the energy to make skeletons out of calcium carbonate. Since zooxanthellae use a process of photosynthesis, it gets a greenish color. But to protect from sunlight, zooxanthellae make themselves into many different colors. So when climate levels rise, the chlorophyll inside the zooxanthellae gets damaged and can cause problems for the coral. This leads the coral to eject zooxanthellae from its system as a stress procedure, leaving its skeleton bare. Since coral is part of the cnidarian family, the family related to anemones and jellyfish, it can still rely on catching floating bacteria or small fish with its stinging tentacles. But because of the loss of its main food source, it has a much higher chance of dying due to starvation. To reproduce, corals use their polyps. Each coral usually houses hundreds to thousands of coral polyps, and each coral polyp annually mass produces hundreds of eggs and sperm into the ocean. To reproduce, corals can reproduce sexually and asexually. Once a coral egg gets fertilized, it has to land on the rock, which will be the base of the coral structure. Once latched on, the coral will start as a polyp and grow 4 inches every year. As a whole, corals can theoretically live forever, or at least thousands of years. This cycle goes on every year, and over time these colonies can grow huge and cause corals to grow big enough to form entire coral reefs, which then can provide shelter and food for thousands of marine life. Because of climate change and the rise of seagrass in the coral reef ecosystem, this cycle isn't happening as much as it used to be, and coral numbers are dropping. Coral reef ecosystems take up less than 1% of the ocean, but house over 30% of marine life. Removing this system can cause damages on a breathtaking scale, both to humans and marine life. So to help save these ecosystems, use healthy types of energy, buy safer fertilizer, eat sustainable or no fish at all, try composting and putting trash in the right bins, and most importantly, respect this and all other ecosystems on the planet. We only have one. And what happens to it is in our hands.